Hi, I'm Pip Courtney from ABC Landline. One thing I've noticed in my travels in the bush is the problems rural people have getting the same level of medical care as people living in the city. Tonight's Australian story is about a doctor who's come up with an ambitious idea to change this. Rolf Gomes is a cardiologist. He's designed a mobile heart clinic, affectionately known as the Heart Bus. It travels from town to town, treating patients and giving them a much better chance of surviving heart disease. This is Rolf Gomes' story.
The day I saw open heart surgery, I was completely hooked. It was just an amazing, almost spiritual experience for me to see a heart pulsating in the open chest. This is life.
We didn't know anything about it except this cardiologist was coming to talk about a truck for the bush. He sort of laid out his pitch to us about these big cardiology diagnostic truck driving around, seeing patients and saving lives. I think my first reaction was, well, that's a fantastic idea, but, you know, it's a bit of a tell him he's dreaming.
Rolf's always had the ideas and everybody else has just had to toddle behind him pretty much.
Yeah, any pain in the chest?
No pain, but I've done the lock-up.
This was never going to be an easy sell, but people can no longer say that services such as this cannot be delivered.
I can't believe there's such a person that wants to do it, but he's doing it.
Good to have your company, whether you're in Normanton in the north or Birdsville in the southwest, whether you're in Boulia, Charleville and everywhere in between. Looks like a fine and sunny day.
Most people living out in very remote areas wouldn't live anywhere else. They really love it. But they put their health on the back burner typically, and they only come in when they're sick or have got a finger falling off or a limb falling off.
Patrick Boyton. How are you, Patrick?
Well, heart disease, it's still the biggest killer. If you live out in the bush away from the city centre, you actually have a 44% greater chance of dying of heart disease.
I was looking through your echocardiogram you had last time.
So you can't look at a situation like that and say the way to address that is to maintain the status quo. Because whatever already exists, clearly we need to be doing more.
It's been over, what? Well, over 12 months since this has been checked.
Right. And who normally checks your defibrillator?
You.
We're not talking about a lack of butchers, bakers, candlestick makers. It's a lack of specialists.
So when are you getting the next bus?
I'd love to get another one. Okay. Go more places.
You do something like this because there's got to be a passion for doing something worthwhile. Giving something back to the country which had given me everything. We grew up in Calcutta. The one thing I remember about Calcutta is it being a bit like an ant's nest. There'd be people everywhere. I never really felt the hardship of the poverty there, but clearly it was everywhere.
We were just working middle class. Mark and myself had full-time jobs. Our living conditions were really bad. Our electricity used to go off quite often. Sometimes even the gas would be switched off, so you couldn't cook at night. First, I had the three boys. Clive was my eldest boy. One day, he woke up saying that he had a headache, he had a slight temperature.
My parents had taken him to the hospital and I think they had some issue with the power in the hospital, and the advice was to go home and bring him back the next day.
I said, look at him, he doesn't even want to have his milk or anything.
My dad said he was lying in bed with him and rolled over and found he was stone cold. I sometimes try and put the pieces together as to what could have possibly done, but I don't really probe into it.
The medical system failed us to some extent.
I think he had appendicitis and not detected. You can have appendicitis even at the age of two.
A few years later, we decided to come to Australia.
As my dad said, he stepped off a plane with $200 and four suitcases, four children, to come to a country so his kids could have a better life.
When you arrive in Australia at 40 with four kids, it's a lot of sacrifice. We've got really strong work ethic. My dad worked two jobs till I think he was about 70. So you can see where it all comes from. My mum as well.
My dad only wanted me to sit with the books day and night. He didn't allow me to cook.
Study.
Day and night.
My parents, as strict as they were, all they really wanted to make sure was that I did well at school, and I didn't find it particularly hard, to be honest. I was working as an electrical engineer, and I started to come to the realisation that I enjoyed people more than computers. I moved from Melbourne, drove up to Brisbane in 1998. To start studying medicine. The engineering side of me probably drew me towards cardiology because, in a sense, the heart is very much a muscular pump. It's got some chambers, some valves, some plumbing, some electrics. And there it goes for 70, 80 years. It never stops for a coffee break. You couldn't go to Bunnings and buy a pump off the shelf and say, I'll come back in 80 years and I hope it's still working. It is an amazing organ.
Well, I first met Rolf back in 2002. He was a medical student. I guess in the medical fraternity was probably one of the wild socialites at that time. I think I thought he was going to be a lot of fun and definitely not boring. We ended up getting engaged fairly quickly after we moved in together, and we got married within another year after that.
The second year of your residency, they encourage you to go out to rural areas. I loved the hospitality of the country hospitals, and the people were just so grateful and accepting of what they had. But it was difficult trying to practice the style of medicine which you could practice in the city. I remember there was a guy, he'd fallen off his quad bike, and I was trying to convince him that you really need to go get an X-ray of your neck. And he was four hours away from Longreach, I think, and he said, oh, I just can't travel. So I put him in a collar and went home that night, and lying in bed staring at the ceiling thinking, Jesus Christ, is this guy going to be able to move his legs in the morning?
He questioned why there wasn't more specialists out there, or why there wasn't the services out there.
I ended up going directly into private practice as a sole cardiologist in Brisbane. I'd walk into my practice and I'd look around and I'd see treadmills and ultrasound machines and heart rhythm monitoring machines. And I think, well, this is what we actually do. This is what a cardiologist does. So I thought, well, why can't we put all this equipment in a mobile vehicle and take it out there? So the first thing was, Rolf, is it just you who thinks this is a good idea? So I wrote to 181 GPs around the bush.
Ralph came out to St George, where I was in practice as a GP, and he spoke to the GPs and the local community. Well, we've had people in our town, and a member of our own family died at the age of around about 32 of an undiagnosed heart condition. We do have other outreach services. However, the access is not the same. Everyone said, yes, we really need that service.
And so it was a no-brainer after that. The need was there. It was just a matter of getting the service out to them and how he was going to deliver that. I think the next stage was, I think he thought a truck would be pretty cool.
Well, I thought we'd have to raise $1 million to build the trailer and probably $1 million in sponsorship to run the program.
He was talking about having federal government, state government, local government, industry, hospitals, the local community, the GPs, all coming together for this concept around this cardiology truck. I really didn't want to burst his bubble, but to be honest, I thought something is going to have to go very right for him to be able to get this venture off the ground.
When all you have is a vision and a bunch of PowerPoint slides, you're really asking people to take a leap of faith.
The only time I've ever seen him disheartened is when people can't see his vision. He used to just go to meetings after meetings after meetings, and people would just sort of, you know, they could see that his ideas were valid, but, you know, he didn't have someone on his side.
I'm the former mayor of the Blanchard Council. This project is just the most amazing project for the bush that I've ever heard of. This is bringing heart care right to the doorstep of the people.
I suppose that was the start of where things started to pick up a bit.
Donna opened up a lot of doors for Rolf. She's very well connected and knows a lot of people.
Well, he needed some funding. There was a lot of activity going on in the resource area, particularly in Western Queensland. So I suggested to him that they were probably the best people to approach because they were trying to promote themselves as good corporate citizens.
Harrow Energy, they came on board as our major partner. And I had just had that warm, fuzzy feeling of finally something had clicked. Then I had to work out how much do I really believe in this idea to put my own skin in the game. Well, then I said, I need the money and we need to refinance the house.
I wasn't too keen on it, to be honest. We had really young children at that stage and life was fairly hectic. We're still in the, you know, really early stages of just setting up, you know, a business and a house. There's no point trying to fight Rolf on anything. He, once he sets his mind to it, he's going to do it.
So Kylie and I remortgaged our house, borrowed $800,000.
We all were amazed that Rolf was doing it as a private venture. I know there are corporate supporters. I know it's a very expensive service. And we all felt that, well, he's doing a brave thing here.
Having come from a background where I was, in a funny sort of way, unencumbered by wealth and reputation, for me, the only way was up. I love building the truck. My engineering side of it really enjoyed that process.
There was many, many hurdles to overcome in just being able to put such a large thing on the road and making sure all the equipment didn't get, you know, bounced around so much that it didn't work properly.
And then he called to talk to us about all of the cardiology equipment that he needed for inside the truck. And so we said, oh, this is fantastic. And And so we started speccing up all of the equipment that he'd need and helped him fit it out, and so it was ready to go.
Tomorrow, when we hit the road for St. George and then Charleville, patients will have at their doorstep everything patients in my Brisbane practice take for granted when they walk in there, and more.
The Heart of Australia truck was launched on the 4th of October 2014, but really it had been 5 years from when I first had started. The truck never comes back into the city. It does 8,000 kilometres of travel a month. It does 12 regional communities. Finding people who have high blood pressure, finding people who have high cholesterol, intervening, you can prevent a lot of problems down the track.
Welcome to the Heart of Australia.
Yep.
In the first 6 months, there were 9 patients who I had referred for open heart surgery.
Yeah, and then the doctor, he was checking me over, and he said, I think I'd be a bit more concerned about your heart than a snake bite.
Yeah, you have got a murmur.
Yeah, I got a bit of a murmur.
Now, these are the type of procedures that, left unattended, you could potentially die.
What I need to do is have a look at these valves again.
We've now seen in excess of 2,000 patients. And there are people out there who would never have seen a cardiologist. And both your parents had heart problems?
Yeah.
Heart attacks?
Yeah. And we have cerebral brain damage.
Where were you born?
Western Queensland.
Augustella.
I've had 2 brothers that had heart attacks, you know, and it's not always, you don't always have to be old. You can be quite young.
We've just added another town to our route, which is Winton, and it's about 15 hours drive northwest of Brisbane.
You come into this place, don't we?
Yep.
James lives about an hour south of Winton, and Bob lives nearly 2 hours northeast.
I just thought it was about time to get something done.
Yeah. Oh, you're a crook.
Jimmy had a cardiac stent inserted about 16 years ago, and he hasn't seen a cardiologist since.
I've learned over the years to invite the spouses in because they make great lie detectors.
Really, for someone like himself, he should be seeing a cardiologist every 6 to 12 months.
The slightest little thing, you sort of feel what's happening, you know, like it's, you're more on board there. I do sort of, feel different things there. Now, whether it is anything, I don't really know, you know.
He started to get some chest pain whilst on the treadmill.
Well, let me know if it gets any worse. Hey?
Yeah.
Have you felt that before when you exert yourself?
Yeah.
We're sort of at the stage now that you've got symptoms, you've got some ECG changes with the stress test, you've had troubles with your heart in that area before, and I think we've probably got enough justification to think about another angiogram.
And how's your health been in the past? Any serious illnesses, any operations? Do you take tablets for anything?
Oh, I had my arm taken. Went round the back and took my arm straight off, yeah.
A helicopter blade?
5 months ago, I went to get in the helicopter and I misjudged and the rotor at the back took my arm off.
Medicine is really a people profession. You know, if there's one thing I love in life, it's people. Here's a guy who's almost lost his arm when it got chopped off in the rear rotor of his chopper, and he talks about it like, you know, he cut himself shaving.
I went down, I looked up and I saw the stub and I had another look and I thought, there's no good looking again, it's gone. Where the helicopter hit the bone, they had to cut it off and attach it together with super glue probably, but...
Now, yesterday when I had a chat to you and listened to your heart, there was a heart murmur there. What really needs to happen is we've got to replace that valve.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's only going to get worse over time.
Mm.
And when it gets to that degree of
narrowing, the risk of dying is not insignificant.
So how did you go at the cardiologist?
Leaking valve, yeah, in my heart.
Yeah. Does everybody want tea?
We had planned for Bob to have his valve replaced. Unfortunately, as luck would have it, his chihuahua bit him on the hand and he ended up with an infected knuckle. In that situation, we really have to wait at least 8 weeks before we can go ahead with his operation. So for many of our patients who live on the land, who don't have 9-to-5 jobs, to actually find time to come into the city to have invasive tests done is quite difficult.
Adam, lift it up now, ready. Lift.
Good boy. Something come up on the ECG that, yeah, does warrant sort of a bit of a look, yeah.
That'll give him a feed, mate, eh?
I've got to see my grandson grow up and see my youngest son married, so, yeah.
It's just one of those things. It's your health that's you've got to look after, so, yeah. Mm-hmm. Haven't got a choice, really. You've got to go and get it checked out.
Okay.
You've been
angio
today, James?
Yes, that's right.
Okay,
you're travelling all the way from Winton?
Yeah, I'm going for a little trip now. No.
Yeah,
I didn't want to come down here because, yeah, no sooner as you go away, something goes wrong. So far, to my knowledge, everything's okay. So, yeah. No news is good news. I suppose you could take it that way.
Okay, let's bring the screens down and we'll get started. That is the old stent that they put in all those years ago. It has got worse over time, but your body has responded quite well by developing that collateral network. And I think it really gives us a clear indication of how we need to map your treatment going forward. And so we need a higher level of vigilance now, more regular follow-up and careful.
Oh, I think there's a ton of weight gone off the shoulders. We're still a long way to go yet anyway. Might end up seeing that boy married or something, I suppose, eh?
The Heart of Australia, it was an ambitious pilot, but, you know, in the last 18 months, what we've shown is that there is a way to deliver services out into these areas. So in the last 24 hours, we've been deeply disappointed that the state government has rejected our proposal to partner with Heart of Australia to help extend the service. A stage 1A assessment of your proposal has found that it does not meet the following key criteria to proceed as a market-led proposal. Point 1, community need and government priority. Point 2, value for money. Why wouldn't the government be more interested? I lie in bed and I stare at the ceiling trying to work out reasons why.
I think with any venture like this, it's going to be political as well. There's political priorities, there's funding priorities, there's competing interests for funds. So it's always going to be difficult for this sort of a venture to get public funding. I think what we need to see is some independent health economics work done in this area to be able to measure the impact that the Heart of Australia is having.
You know, I'm quite happy for people to be doing research and white papers and blue papers and stepping stones and pathways, but let's make sure people aren't dying in the meantime. I first met you, your heart rate was a lot higher than what it is now.
Anecdotally, we know of lots of people, even in our own town, that have been helped by, as they call it, the heart bus. Sitting in your office in Brisbane, you wouldn't be seeing those outcomes.
How are you feeling, Lester? Any pain in the chest?
No, mate. No, I'm a bit short of wind, though.
I think over the next 5 years, maybe the figures might show an improvement due to the Heart of Australia being around.
You had the heart attack, that was a while ago. What we're doing now is giving you every chance of not having another one.
This is not the end of our discussion with government.
this is the start of the fight. Whether they like it or not, the service is here, and I think in time to come it'll just become stronger and stronger.
So tell me where you go, Rolf.
The RACQ have come on board as a partner.
12 towns, but a couple of them we alternate.
A lot of our members, you know, live in regional centres, and I thought, wow, this is an organisation that saves lives.
Cunnamulla's written a lot of letters saying, can we go down there?
This is the second largest sponsorship that RACQ will be involved in, the first being our rescue helicopter network. So it is a sizeable amount of cash investment.
We start off Thursday in Dalby, end up Sunday night in Charleville.
So the level of sponsorship is $100,000 over the next 3 years, so that's $100,000 per year for the next 3 years.
I'm gathering a bunch of friends in the private sector and a lot of friends out in the communities which are going to get behind this and make sure it's successful one way or the other. It could get to the point where government are embarrassed because they haven't come on board earlier.
There's a number of examples of the public and private sector in partnership to provide healthcare. I think it really makes good sense where it's providing good quality and efficient healthcare.
Yeah, I think he's got a big job now, just trying to maintain sponsorships and funding and just to keep it going.
There he is. Who likes Daddy's truck?
Me.
Come on.
Yeah, me.
Who wants to have a look inside?
And I guess time-wise, family-wise, it was very taxing. I guess for myself and the children, he was away a lot.
Yes. Are you sick? You want to be the patient?
One of the other reasons why he's doing this, I think he wants to teach his children that you don't just have to accept things the way they are.
Your heart's going.
You can just get up yourself and try and make those changes yourself.
Is that a good heart?
Should we listen to Teddy's?
I've given it everything I've got, and I'll continue to do that. I do what I do because I really like doing it. And, well, I can't think of anything else I'd rather be doing.
Oh, is Teddy all right?
Yeah.